Don't let the stack of stuff scare you. I'm not going to go through all of it. I just use it as really as visual aids. How many of you have looked around and you've said, how do we get here so fast? You know, what's really going on here? What else is in the room with this thing? And well, let me just give you a little hint. This is just stuff, this is extra. Gay and Lesbian Victory Institute, if you go on their website, you can find during the Obama administration, these were the LGBT activists who were appointed to every federal agency. And so they've engaged every federal agency and embedded it with activism and engaged it, of course, on the education topic here. Over two dozen of those activists appointed were in the Department of Education alone. So that's why you're seeing a lot of what we're looking at. The last 8 years have been supercharged with activism. And you do have to realize, if you take the LGBT movement at face value, you have made a mistake. If you think it's about civil rights, you've made a mistake. If you think it's about gay love, you've made a mistake, because there is so much more in the room on this. I mean, this past administration has not empowered this agenda for the sake any more than the pro-abortion groups care about women's reproductive rights. Right. So you understand that there's more in the room. What I want to give you is a couple of little pictures of what's going on. Where did LGBT come from? Originally, it was GLBT, and you'll see those changes. Then it's LGBTQ, QQI, A, and so on. We're going to run out of letters in the alphabet, but there was actually a meeting in 2006, and from that came a set of principles out of Indonesia, Yogyakarta principles. Anybody ever heard of that? This was developed as a sort of the new language for human rights, and this was set out of Indonesia. And I want to read this to you because it has a lot to do with how civil rights are interpreted, human rights are interpreted. The principles were developed to enhance the individual sovereignty, listen to me closely, individual sovereignty of subjective identity, a principle articulated in a host of international human rights laws that protect the authentic reality of individual identity and sovereignty from the legal fictions and social constructs of national or state collectivist ideologies. Did you get that, or you want me to read to you again? But what we're facing is an effort to redefine human rights and using the LGBT to do it. And when you start seeing the word dignity begin to surface, dignity is actually more core to your rights of freedom of speech or your rights of freedom of religion. Dignity becomes the core issue. And of course, it is essentially and first and foremost assigned to the LGBT community. So their rights actually supersede, just like with this whole bathroom stuff. The one in perhaps 30,000 transgendered person or person who is gender confused, their rights to be celebrated, recognized, protected, their feelings protected, accommodated, are to be empowered to subject everyone else, their right of privacy and so forth. But make no mistake, on the education front, I'll just show this stuff really quick. What you're up against is comprehensive sexuality education. How many of you know what this is? Do you know where it came from? It came from Planned Parenthood. So the biggest promoter of homosexuality in today's world is indeed Planned Parenthood. This is a global effort. This is UNESCO 2014 talking about it, the challenges and opportunities of scaling up. Now, specifically, this will teach your child a range of LGBT ideology and normalization, even against the parents and against the faith community. So those are really the two targets that have to be overcome. So you'll see why my point being how this is affecting the church is going to affect you as a Christian parent, or the parent, the faith values from your family tradition that you try to pass on to your kids. It will be in direct conflict to it. They know it. They don't care. And so what you're looking at, this is K through 5. So give you a really quick history on this. It's been around since 1964. That's when CECUS was funded, spun off of Planned Parenthood by Mary Calderon, the former medical director, and her husband was head of World Health Organization. And so they began to develop this, really a sexual liberation ideology. If you want to read it, this is available on CECUS website. But This is also being implemented in some test run some schools, and that's probably what our friend Carol encountered, a willingness to try to run it here with four-year-olds in pre-K 3 and pre-K 4. This stuff is realized from their perspective as a human right at any age. It is sexual liberation. It's you have to understand the ideology of Planned Parenthood and Margaret Sanger. You need to read a good biography or even go Google some quotes on there on the internet, and you find out what she's really like. But she said the church was an outdated institution that needed to be done away with. That's us. That's why, as a minister trying to preach God's word and be faithful to it, am a target of this. And that's why you, as a believer, or in your house of worship, are being targeted for this. Another way that this invades your lives, your family, your faith is the Adelman and Taylor's guide from UCLA for mental health. So you have to watch your public schools mental health model, their counseling model. I can make all these things available for you. But this is their sexual minority student focus. So the counseling is specifically. Now, what can come home to you and even to your church through one of the other kids in the youth group, or perhaps even from your child, is some of the product of all these training manuals that are out there. Here's one. So Change It, a guide for high school youth activists. This is by Advocates for Youth. If you get on Advocates for Youth, you'll find out that they're a spinoff of Planned Parenthood as well. By the way, you know, under Obama, what the public funding went to for Planned Parenthood? Over $500 million, and then another $500 million plus from private sources. So you're talking about $1 billion with a B a year to push this agenda forward. This is the United Nations, same youth training activist guide for comprehensive sexuality. They're demanding their sexual rights now. This is another more developed youth tool activist kit. This is rights, respect, and responsibility, also Advocates for Youth. So little Johnny at school can come home to your house if he lives there, or to your kid's classroom, and be pushing back on all of the sexual norms and pushing back on your faith beliefs. And you can be put in the place, as we know already, that you're a hater if you're withstanding that, if you don't submit to it. Now, Human Rights Campaign, the reason you are where you are in Texas right now, we experienced in 2014 when they came to Birmingham. I was asked by a Southern Baptist friend, because I'm not in any of the official lobby or activist organizations within the SBC, so I was asked unofficially to meet with the Human Rights Campaign, who had asked for a meeting with him. He felt like him meeting them would legitimize them. So a friend and I that do apologetics, we met with them, and we sat for 4.5 hours, and we asked, what's your goal? You have $8.5 million. I'll show you that in a minute. So you're here to push an agenda. Well, what they didn't know that I already knew about was what they were doing in education, because February 14th, the Day of Love, Valentine's Day, they had already had their first Time to Thrive conference. And isn't Las Vegas a great place to have a youth conference? But it says something about the culture, though, doesn't it? But anyway, then they had the next one in Portland, 2015. By this time, not only is the National Education Association sponsoring it, AT&T, Health and Human Services, DOJ, and Department of Education are actually presenting. They are sponsors. Presenters in participating in this. And then, of course, the reason why Dallas is getting all this, or Texas is getting all this, their 2016 meeting was here near Dallas. So they've really brought a lot of, they're opening field offices here, so HRC has a vast amount of resources that they brought to bear on your state. So the reason I'm getting to that is, they're not only coming at your children, they don't want to leave any quarter, not only in the public schools, even in the houses of worship. They want to bring this agenda in where they can saturate the landscape and begin to win over hearts and minds. And years ago, they had a more radical approach, not that many years ago. How many of you read the Huffington News? Okay, how many think that's a good source media. Okay, good. The Huffington Post, Michael Huffington actually funded this thing, and this is Human Rights Campaign for The Bible Tells Me So. What this was a mockumentary CD and accompanying training manual to take Christians head on for the LGBT to do a full frontal assault. This was 2007. And so what they did is they made all the case for the bullying and the health problems, the drug use, the depression, the suicide, even had a postmortem of a young lesbian girl who had hung herself with a dog chain, and all this stuff. And they brought it and dumped it on the laps of evangelical Christians. They brought it to the doorstep of a Focus on the Family. And so with all these legal institutions behind them, they're pushing this thing on them. But actually by 2014, we had My Mind Was Changed. This is available on groundswell.org. This was funded by Arcus Foundation, one of the big funders. It said, a new way to talk with conflicted Christians about lesbian, gay, bisexual, and transgender people in church and society. Okay, this changes you, tells the activists how to take you out of your framework, what you think as an evangelical Christian, and move you into their framework and move that toward what you should think. Okay, old approach, new approach, full frontal assault, come alongside, be nice, and let's talk about it. So it's a conversation guide. So when the Human Rights Campaign were in our state, you're going to love this, they had $8.5 million in order to focus on the three backwaters of civilization in America: Alabama, Mississippi, and Arkansas, right? And what they said is, if you can get the job done in Mississippi, you can get it done anywhere. And we had one openly lesbian legislator. She became the chairman of the new chapter that they began there. But they had Project One America going. Doesn't that sound great? See the American flag. They wrap this thing in patriotism, wrap it in faith. And so this was $8.5 million to bring their agenda into the churches. Here's the nifty little conversation guide that they have, and it is creating safe and inclusive spaces for people who are LGBT in the churches. So this is what we sat down to talk about, was their effort behind this. And of course, they didn't want to own the money, and they didn't really want to own how organized this whole thing was. They certainly didn't give me this toolkit. I obtained it sort of stealthily. But anyway, this is what you can do. This is what you could do, Brian, if you had $8.5 million. But I mean, they've got another $50 million in their general budget. I don't think you're budgeted anything like that. Yeah, okay. But you can see how, really, people ask me, how's this moving so fast? Well, it's easy. It's money. Money. Money is doing this. And so then the obvious question after that is, why? I asked them plainly, I said, so what are you doing in our churches? I said, well, we're sending gay couples in to see how they react, and we're also how the church reacts, and we're sending transgender teens in, teens who may be a boy, may be a girl, not certain, or very effeminate, or very masculine, or whatever, just to see how the churches react, and then we'll know where to concentrate our resources. So the churches were sort of being given this litmus test. And my own church, I'm not a pastor, I'm an evangelist actually, but my own church was getting really wiggly about all this. And I said, look, I mean, nothing's changed. The word of God's forever settled in heaven. It doesn't change. But I want to, if you are not in the Christian faith or not in the faith at all, you may feel that that Christians are being picked on. Actually, they're not. This is called gay religion. This is how they're working within every faith tradition, including Muslims and LDS, Catholic, and the evangelical community, and Hindu, the whole thing. They have someone from their tradition who knows how they think to work to bring about an acceptance of both their fundamental beliefs about homosexuality and yet the idea that you can be that and homosexual. And an example to the co-author here, Scott Thuma, he has written the fourth chapter, which says how they're negotiating a gay Christian identity. So be careful with all the language that's changing around us. I'm sympathetic when people are still dealing with temptation from the past, but when suddenly we can be this and we can be that together with something that's diametrically opposed, that's what this whole sociology approach is and what they're talking about here. They don't mind combining the two total opposites. But On the faith front, we also have guys like Matthew Vines. Anybody heard of him? Reformation Project. He wrapped, of course, when you say Reformation, we're thinking Martin Luther, but what he's out to do is reform. He dropped out of Harvard, was so compelled. His family was victimized by a non-affirming church when he came out as gay. And so he set out to discover what the Bible really says. So he takes four Old Testament verses and three New Testament verses and tries to dismantle the case. Well, I can tell you, you don't have to know Hebrew or Greek or be much of a theologian to blow this thing out of the water. I won't take time to dig into all of it. But so you've got that kind of friendly face. He's like a young guy that all the ladies would want to mother, and they get along a long way on the sympathies of women with this movement. But the whole idea was to start dismantling the Bible, what it says about it. And there's no ambiguity in the Bible about this, but it's not about other sexual sin either. But I simply want to point out a couple of things to you. If you want to look down the spectrum and see what gay liberation or queer liberation theology does, is it actually sees the entire Christian faith through the lens of homosexuality. And Robert Goss would be a good person. He's one of the most celebrated theologians. And so he is able to bring this stuff forward in a way that is very shocking to you. He's celebrated because of his fixation, a homoerotic fixation on the crucified Christ. Now, I want to just give you some scriptures so you can know how you can address this, because the church does need to respond to people in homosexuality. The church does not need to accommodate gay activists who want to push all this stuff in. And so just in the last closing minutes here, I want to give you a couple of things. All people are broken. We're all broken because we're all sinners. The Apostle Paul said, I'm the chief of sinners. And if you haven't found that out about the man in the mirror when you look at him or her in the morning, then just look a little harder and ask God's Spirit to reveal. I mean, we are all sinners. And so there's a beautiful picture in John 4 of Jesus ministering to a woman in utter sexual brokenness. She was an outcast. She was a Samaritan. She was a reject. She had had five husbands and was living with another man. And she walks out to the well out when nobody else is out there, and there sits Jesus, and he set her up. It's one of those divine setups. And she comes to him, and he says, give me something to drink. And then he says, he's got living water. You know the conversation well. But what he does is he confronts her. They talk a little bit about politics and religion, or the politics of religion and history. And then he addresses her need. He goes right to it. He confronts her. She is repentant over the life that she's lived, and then she is given one of the clearest revelations of who Jesus is in all of the New Testament. He says, I'm him. I'm the Messiah. The Bible is not ambiguous about marriage. Why marriage is important? We've given up marriage in our culture, but we should not give up the fight to regain it, because it's God's institution. Genesis said it in chapter 1, chapter 2, that God made them male and female. You know, that's gender specific, isn't it? It's gender specific in their roles. And he said, I mean, it's really pretty black and white. I say, you don't have to be a theologian to get this. But then he actually attends that marriage ceremony. He performed that first marriage ceremony. And when Jesus is asked about divorce, he said that what God has joined together, don't let man put asunder. So there is a divine role that God plays in a Christian marriage, or in a marriage that's brought before him at the altar. And above all, Ephesians says that marriage is to be a picture of Christ and the church. So we're to be modeling to the world how God loves. And that's why these complementary roles are so important. I want to share with you what is probably the most stigmatized verse in regard to homosexuality, and that is Romans 1. And usually if I'm in a meeting and I say I'm going to read from Romans 1, people just kind of cringe. But it is hard-hitting about homosexuality and about a lot of other sins. But what he starts out saying, and this is what I would ensure that we need to get, is Paul's going into the seat of power, and he's going to take on the idolatry and the immorality. Idolatry, he's taking on Caesar himself, head to head. and because he's a living idol in his own mind, right? And so he takes it on. He plans to go there. The church has already been planted there by the work of the Holy Spirit. There's even believers in Caesar's own household. And so Paul desires to get there, but he's in prison and he's writing and he's waiting for his chance to get there. And he says, but I am not ashamed of the gospel, because it is the power of God to salvation, to everyone who believes, the Jew first, the Gentile. He said, because in it, the righteousness of God is revealed from faith to faith. So the righteousness of God is revealed in the gospel. And then he says, but the wrath of God is revealed in those who do these things. And he is very explicit. And so what's actually happening with all this is an outright effort to get us to accept a specific sin with special status, to change what God said about it for what the social structure and the culture and these societal change mechanisms and theories of social change are telling us we should say. Lastly, I would like to say, to protect your family, you need to engage your kids and your grandkids. Grandparents, you need to engage that couple that are raising your grandkids. You cannot assume what they think about this, because the culture's being marinated. Even the church is being marinated in this stuff. So last, I want to leave with you those three words that Jesus said: remember Lot's wife. And then I refer you to 2 Peter 2:4-10. What happened to Lot's family when he decided to live in the city of Sodom, when he set up his home there, he raised his family there, he lost the two daughters and their husbands. They wouldn't even listen to him. They were already lost. He tried to intervene to save these angels, and the angels had to show their power to save even his household. He was so distorted because he had become influential and was sitting in the city gates. And I close with this. He was sitting there willing to offer his two virgin daughters to those men to satiate them. This agenda can ruin your family. Don't let it happen. Be true to God's word and to the faith that we've inherited from our fathers. Amen.